Yes guys, let's turn to the question number 5. The following is an extract of balance sheet of Popular Limited. There's a balance sheet given to you. Additional information goes like this. The replacement values of fixed assets are 1100 and 1250 on 31st March 2011 and 31st March 2012. The rate of depreciation to be adopted on the fixed assets is 5%. 50% of the stock is valued at 120% of book value. 50% of the investment can be considered as trade investment, so balance 50% should be non-trade. Debtors as on 31st March 2012 include foreign debtors of 35,000 recorded in the books at 35 rupees per dollar. The closing rate was 39 rupees per dollar. Creditor on 31st March 2012 included a foreign creditor of $60,000 recorded at 33 rupees per dollar. The closing exchange rate as already given to you is 39 rupees per dollar. The profit for the year 2011-12 included 60 lakhs of government subsidy which is not likely to recur. 125 lakhs of research and development expenditure was written off to the P&L in the current year. This expenditure is not likely to recur. Future maintainable profits pre-tax are likely to be higher by 10%. So there's a trend which is given as 10%. The tax rate during the year 2011-12 was 50% while the future effective tax rate is only 40%. Normal rate of profit is 15%. One of the directors of the company, Arvind Limited, fears that the company does not enjoy goodwill in the prevalent market conditions. Critically examine and establish whether Popular company has or has not any goodwill. If your answer is positive with the existence of goodwill, then identify what is the leveraged effect that on the company's results. Industrial average return is 12% on long-term funds and 15% on equity funds. Now this particular question is talking about something called as leveraged effect. Leveraged effect of goodwill. Now how do we understand or how do we identify this leveraged effect of goodwill? Now whenever we are identifying goodwill, goodwill is always identified for equity funds. Now if you are trying to identify the goodwill for the long term funds and compare it to the equity funds, we get the leveraged effect. In the sense, we are trying to compare goodwill as per equity funds. This is what we normally calculate. And compare with goodwill as per long-term funds. This will give us the leveraged effect of goodwill. Now, whenever we are trying to calculate this goodwill, let's say we have a goodwill for equity funds as 100 and long-term funds is, let's say, 200. Then we can say that there's a negative leverage because the long-term funds goodwill is higher than the equity funds. That means majority of the goodwill is going to those long-term funds who are not equity funds. So we can say that this is a negative leverage. So whenever we are trying to identify the leverage, it's just not asking you what is a equity fund goodwill, is also asking you the leveraged effect. So we need to calculate even for the long-term funds. Now how do we calculate this long-term fund goodwill? Goodwill as per long-term funds. Your equity funds are also long-term funds. In addition to equity funds, what we have as long-term funds is your long-term loans. We'll check in the question given to you, there's an 18% term loan which is given, which is a long-term fund. So we have to consider even the goodwill for the long-term fund, including the term loan. So what happens? Whenever we calculate the FMP calculated is post-tax. Whenever we calculate FMP, FMP is post-tax FMP. But when we are trying to calculate for the long-term funds, this FMP post-tax already deducted the amount of interest on long-term funds. So what we do is, we add back the interest. Interest on long-term funds always compulsorily adjust it for tax. Simple reason is because your FMP is post-tax and your interest is always pre-tax. So we have to adjust it for tax so that we get post-tax funds. And once we complete this, we get FMP for long-term funds. Like always, FMP is always post-tax. Even here we get post-tax FMP for long-term funds. Now, along with this, we need to check even for our capital employed. So normally when we calculate, we calculate capital employed for equity funds. So when we are trying to calculate capital employed for long-term funds, while calculating equity funds, we deduct outside liabilities. And one such outside liability is your long-term funds. So what we do here, we need adding back. We'll add back long-term funds. And that will give you capital employed for long-term funds. Your NRR will be different because equity NRR is always higher than debt NRR. Your simple FM strategy where they say that the cost of debt is always cheaper than cost of equity. So when we are calculating long-term funds, it includes even debt. So what happens to the equity NRR? Equity NRR is high. Long-term fund NRR, since you are averaging it with the long-term loans, slightly fall down. So whenever we have this, you need to consider the third determinant is NRR for long-term funds. Now, we have already seen that there are three determinants for goodwill. First determinant of goodwill is your FMP. Second determinant is your capital employed. Third determinant is your NRR. So once we have these three informations, we can directly calculate what is your goodwill. We can say that whenever we are following super profits method, NRR into capital employed will give you normal profits. Compare it with FMP, we get super profits. Multiplied by number of years purchased, we get the goodwill. Now these are the three determinants which we need to calculate your long-term fund goodwill, and we have all the three determinants. Take down these determinants. So yes guys, let's start the problem. The first determinant that we have to calculate is FMP. Now, from where do I get the FMP? There's no past profits which are given to us. There's no 1, 2, 3 years past profits where we take an average or something. Or what we can start with is current year profits. Now, from where do I get the current year profits? What is the current year 2011-12? How do I get the current year profits? You can compare your reserves, the opening and the closing reserve, and we can identify what is your current year profit after tax. Now, if you observe, check your general reserve. From 400, it became 425. So, the appropriation to general reserve is 25. Check your P&L. From 60, it became 90. So, the retained earnings are 30. Now, this increase is after the proposed dividend. Can I take proposed dividend appropriation as 25? I'll take the proposed dividend appropriation as the entire 125 because the proposed dividend of 100, which is already existing in the opening balance sheet, must have been already paid in the previous year. You can't carry forward the proposed dividend every year. You have to compulsorily discharge this liability. So what is appropriated in the current year for the proposed dividend is the entire 125 figure. You can't use the same logic what you use for your general reserve and P&L when you're talking about proposed dividend. Because general reserve and P&L balance keeps on carrying forward. But whenever I'm talking about proposed dividend, it is always paid at the end of the year. So what is proposed as 100 rupees in the previous year should have been paid during the year. And the entire 125 is proposed during the year. So considering these three factors, I can calculate what is the amount of current year profits. Now, with the existing current year profits, we have some adjustments which are given in the additional information. We'll pick up that additional information and we'll try to identify what is your FMP. So put down the first determinant heading, FMP. Future maintainable profits. Let's start with the current year profits. The first one, current year profits. Three things that we have to consider: retained earnings, appropriation to general reserve, and appropriation to dividend. So I'll start with retained earnings first. Retained earnings is the increase in P&L. What is the increase in P&L? From 60 to 90, the increase in P&L is 30. All rupees in lakhs. Next, add back all your appropriations. The first appropriation that I see is general reserve. Appropriation to general reserve, 400 to 425, 25. Finally, the proposed dividend. Current year proposed dividend, like I told you, you can't compare with the previous year. The entire dividend proposed in the current year is an appropriation, 125. So my current year profits are 180. Now with the series of adjustments that he has given there, I'll split the adjustments into two parts. The first adjustment is the adjustment to current year profits. To identify the corrected current year profits, what are the adjustments that I have to consider? The second classification of adjustments will be adjustments for FMP. Now, how do I differentiate between current year corrected profits and your adjustment for FMP? Remember guys, adjustments for FMP are non-trade investments income. Non-trade investment income is an income for the current year, but it should not be considered for the computation of FMP. Similarly, non-recurring expenses and incomes. So all abnormal gains and losses which are non-recurring in nature, they are gains and losses which you incur today. But they are non-recurring in nature, so I will not be getting future. So it is an adjustment for FMP, it is not an adjustment for the current year profit. Current year profit will include those expenses and losses, but will not have them in the FMP at all. Now, but in the similar way, whenever a stock is being overvalued, closing stock increase will compulsorily affect my current year profits. So that is the first adjustment that I can consider. So let's try to classify the adjustments. First adjustment, there's an increase in the replacement value of the fixed assets to 1100 and 1250. I'm more concerned about the current year. The current year 650 was the closing figure, but now I'm revaluing it to 1250. What is the increase in the value of fixed assets? 600. On that increase in the value of fixed assets as on 31st March 2012, I'm having an additional depreciation of 5%. When is this additional depreciation applicable? When are you revaluing? I'm revaluing on 31st March 2012. So my additional depreciation should be for the next year. So this is an adjustment for FMP. Because it is only an adjustment to the future profits that I have to depreciate extra 5%. Next. After the depreciation adjustments comes your stock adjustment. Increase in the closing stock. Current year profits will get adjusted. Your current year profits will also increase. This is the adjustment to current year profits. Next. 50% of the investments are trade investments. Balance 50 is non-trade. It's a 10% investment. In the asset side, he has clearly said it is 10% investment. What does it mean? That means the investment yield return of 10%. So, whenever I'm talking about such kind of investment, such an investment income or non-trade investment should be an adjustment for FMP. It is included in the current year profits, but we do not consider it in computation of FMP. Another adjustment for FMP. And what about your debtors and creditors? Debtors and creditors, whenever you have foreign debtors, that is in foreign currency, we always have to restate it at their closing rate according to your AS 11 and try to identify your exchange loss and exchange gain. Such an exchange loss and exchange gain is current year profit adjustment. That is not for the FMP adjustment. It is an adjustment to be done in the current year profits according to AS 11. So your debtors and creditors, both adjustments are current year profit adjustment. So three adjustments so far. Stock is a current year adjustment. Debtor, creditor, both, all the three are your current year adjustments. My future year for the FMP adjustments is depreciation and your non-trade investment income. Continue. The next two are non-recurring items. One is a non-recurring income, government subsidy. One is a non-recurring expenditure, research and development expenditure. Both will be considered as adjustments for FMP again. So that's it. Finally, he is saying FMP is increasing by 10%. Guys, if you observe with the tax rate, the current tax rate is 50, but the effective tax rate is in the future is 40%. So always whenever we have adjustments, try to add back your current year profits to profit before tax. Once you get profit before tax, you can give all the adjustments properly. Otherwise, what we have to do, every time we get the profit, we have to keep adjusting for tax. And unfortunately, the tax rates are also not the same. So you will not get a proper adjustment whenever you are adjusting it. So this is current year profit after tax. Try to get profit before tax and then start giving the adjustments. So one second guys, instead of writing it as current year profit adjustment, let's first convert this. This what I have is current year PAT. If this is current year PAT, calculate current year PBT. Add back your tax. How much was the tax percent deducted? 50. So if 100 rupee was profit, 50 rupees was deducted, balance profits are 50. So if your profit after tax is 50, then profit before tax should be 100, 360, double. Or you can write it as into 100 by 50. So let's give the adjustments now. Adjustment to current year profits. We have total three adjustments to current year profits. Stock, debtor, creditor. Give all the three adjustments. First one, stock. Whenever we have stock, always remember there will be an opening and closing stock adjustment. But here, there's only a closing stock adjustment because it is only the current year's closing stock which is getting affected. 50% of the stock is to be valued at 120% of the book value, that is only for the current year's closing stock. Check what is the stock. 300 is the stock. 50% of the stock is revalued, and that is revalued 20% higher than the book value. So into 20%, that is the increase in the value of a stock. And once the closing stock increases, even your profit increases, and this increase will be 30. Do not take it as 120%. Already 100% is included in stock. So what is the increase in stock? 20% only. My next adjustments are exchange gain or loss, under exchange gain or loss, first one is debtors. Calculate. Everything is in lakhs, guys, remember that, because here everything is given in thousands. 35,000 debtors recorded at 35, closing rate is 39. That means I will receive 4 rupees extra per dollar. So if I am receiving 4 rupees per dollar extra, it is a gain for me. On how many dollars? 35,000. So calculate. $35,000 into 39 minus 35. 4 rupees per dollar. 4 rupees per dollar into 35,000 is 1,40,000. In lakhs, 1.4. Gain. It's an exchange gain, I'm adding it. I'm receiving 4 rupees extra per dollar. When you have to pay extra, then it is a loss. I think creditor is a loss check, you will pay extra. $60,000 recorded at 33, exchange loss is 37. I'm paying 6 rupees per dollar extra for $60,000. 39 minus 33, 6 rupees loss per dollar on $60,000. So 3,60,000 in lakhs, 3.6 negative loss. So this is it for the adjustments of current year profits. So this will give you corrected current year profits. Corrected current year profit before tax. We have already added back tax, we got PBT, so from PBT we are giving these adjustments. So this is 387.8. Now come to adjustment for FMP. All non-recurring items, return on non-trade investments, everything to be considered as an adjustment for FMP. First one, go in the order. Yep, go for the depreciation first. Additional depreciation of fixed assets. Additional depreciation. Calculate 5% depreciation on the addition, revalue to 120, book value 650. So 1250 minus 650, the revaluation is 600 upward. On 600 upward, if I give additional depreciation of 5%, then it should be 30. Positive, negative. Negative, additional depreciation. It should reduce your profits. Second, what is the next adjustment? Stock we have already considered. Investments. Return on non-trade investments. Calculate. 50% is non-trade investment. So 250 into 50% is 125. 10% is the return that they give. 12.5. $250, 50% non-trade yields a return of 10%, 12.5. Next one, debtors considered, creditors considered, non-recurring income and non-recurring gains and losses. Non-recurring gains or losses. We can also call them as abnormal items. Two abnormal items we have. One is government subsidy. Other one is research and development expenditure. Come on. Government subsidy is 120. No, government subsidy is 60. R&D is 125. One should be positive, one should be negative. Which one is positive, which one is negative? Government subsidy is a gain which is already included in the profits. Non-recurring. So I'm reducing the profits. 125 was a research and development expenditure charge to P&L. But in future you will not be having such charge. So your profits will increase to this extent. That's it. That should be your FMP pre-tax. That is the end of the adjustments. We have some trend to be adjusted. We'll adjust that later. But this is FMP pre-tax. Pre-tax FMP adjustments. From here you can start. 410.8. 410.3. We have one more adjustment. Check there. The FMP pre-tax is likely to be higher by 10%. So add trend. At the rate of 10%. Adjusted for trend, it should be 41.03. 10%. Adjusted FMP pre-tax. After adjusting for a trend, it should be, I'm increasing it, so it should be 451.33. That's it. Give tax adjustment finally. What is the future effective tax rate? 40%. Deduct 40% from this. And finally we get FMP post tax. ...40% tax deduct, then you get FMP post-tax. Yes guys, what is the tax to be deducted? So your post-tax FMP is 270.8. Now this is the first determinant that we have calculated, that is FMP. Now there could be a question being asked, why do I split the adjustments into two parts? Why? What is the point of even calculating your corrected current year profits? guys, there will be one adjustment. If there is no opening and closing balance sheet given, then what do? We take closing capital employed. We deduct half of current year profit after tax. But where is current year profit after tax? If I combine everything, then I will never know what is a corrected current year profit after tax. So that is the reason why once I calculate like this, now I know that the current year profit after tax is, profit before tax is 387.8. We can deduct tax and directly take your half of current year profit after tax. So that is the reason why we are splitting. Now I don't need, because now anyways we have your balance sheet to be taken. Come on, let's take the balance sheet now. Capital employed. Two dates, 31st March 2011 and 31st March 2012. Opening, closing. Give your adjustments properly. Start with your assets. First asset, fixed asset. Double 100 and 1250. Investments, only trade investments to be considered. 50% are trade, so I can consider 125. Non-trade investments not to be considered for valuation of goodwill. Stock, we did not adjust the opening stock, we only adjusted the closing stock. 260 plus. Increase in the closing stock is 30, 300 became 330. Guys, he never said whether it is opening stock or closing stock. He just said 50% of the stock is valued at 120% of book value. I took it as closing stock only because he did not specifically say that it is there even for the opening stock. But if I consider the adjustment for both opening as well as closing stock, even here we have to take the opening stock adjustment. Opening stock increases, closing stock, current year profit also reduces. So I'll do 30 plus and 260 is your opening stock, of which 50% of the stock is increased by 20%. 26 I would have deducted. I did not consider that part of adjustment at all, because he did not clearly give that the stock adjustment is for opening stock as well. We will clearly write it down below saying that the current year, the previous year stock has not been adjusted. We have considered the stock adjustment only for the closing stock. Or else, even here also, I would have adjusted the opening stock figure by increasing it by 26. I am not taking that adjustment because it's not specifically given. Debtors, opening debtors no change, closing debtors there is a change. Opening debtors, debtors increased by 1.4. So my debtors 110 plus 1.4, 111.4. Bank balance 46 and 45. This will be your total of assets. Reduce it by your outside liabilities. First outside liability. Go from bottom to top. On the liability side, the first item which I see is proposed dividend, on and outside liability, provision for tax. Compulsorily outside liability, liability to the government, 11 and 13. Next, creditors. There's a change to the current year creditors, guys. Don't forget. 35. Creditor, 45 increased by 3.6, 48.6. Long-term loan, that 18% term loan is there, 180 and 165. That's it. Remaining things are P&L, general reserve, share capital. They are all equity funds. This will be your outside liability, and then we get your capital employed. capital employed for opening and closing. We can take an average of that so that we get average capital employed. Take a simple average. After you get the capital employed, you get average capital employed. That is the second determinant. So your average capital employed is 1554.9. We got two determinants, FMP there, average capital employed there. One more determinant is required. Total three determinants is what we have seen. Check the NRR. Normal rate of return is already given to you as 15%. That's equity fund NRR. 15%, but how do we calculate goodwill? Did he give you a number of years purchase or something? Check the question. One of the directors of company, Arvin, fears that the company does not enjoy the goodwill in the prevalent market conditions. Critically examine to establish whether popular company has or has not any goodwill. Now, he did not talk about number of years purchase. When there is no number of years purchase which is given to you, there is only one method that I can use. That is capitalization method. I clearly told you that a capitalization method does not use number of years purchase. So let's calculate goodwill as per capitalization method. Goodwill as per capitalization method. First, we need to calculate normal capital employed. To calculate your normal capital employed, we'll start using your FMP. FMP post-tax. How much is this? 270.8. NRR. NRR of equity funds is 15%. Divide FMP with the NRR, we get normal capital employed. Compare this with average capital employed. Your average capital employed is definitely lower than the other one. Your average capital employed is 1554.9. Comparing these two, we'll arrive at the figure of goodwill. think this is 1805.33. Check the goodwill, guys. Use your calculators. This goodwill, what we have arrived, is as per equity funds. He's saying that if there is a goodwill, then identify the leveraged effect. We do have goodwill, so we have to identify the leveraged effect. How do we get the leveraged effect? We know this part, goodwill as per equity funds. We need to calculate goodwill as per long-term funds. To get goodwill as per long-term funds, we have another three determinants to be considered. Oh, let's start calculating long-term funds. To get long-term funds goodwill, we need to change FMP. That post-tax FMP should become long-term funds FMP. And your capital employed should become long-term funds capital employed. Because now it is equity fund capital employed, you need to convert it to long-term fund capital employed. NRR will change. NRR is already given to you in the last sentence saying that long-term funds NRR is 12%. It will become lower, guys. When you're calculating long-term funds NRR, obviously it should be lower than equity fund NRR. We know that debt is cheaper than equity. So obviously your NRR on an average will come down. Guys, I actually don't even have to look at the problem. I can directly say that the leverage effect is negative. Simple logic is, what is the NRR for long term fund? 12. What is the long term loans in your balance sheet? 18. By no chance you can say that there's a positive NRR. When the NRR is 12% for long term funds, he's paying 18% interest. So majority of the goodwill will go to the long term funds itself because they are getting higher return. They are getting higher return than the NRR. When you get higher return than the NRR, it is obvious that you have a higher goodwill share. So yes guys, so let's start. FMP as per long term funds. We know the FMP figure first. Keep giving the adjustments. First, let's start with goodwill as per long term funds. The first one I have to calculate is FMP. FMP for long term funds. FMP for long term funds. I know the FMP now. FMP post tax, I know the value. Pick up the value 270.8. We'll add back interest when we are talking about long term funds. Interest should be after tax. It should be adjusted for tax compulsory. This is what we have seen. FMP add interest on long term funds adjusted for tax. Come on, check. Amount 18% on what? 180, 165. You have two values there. What should I consider? 180 or 165 there? Should I consider 180 or 165? Take an average and consider. Take an average and consider because we don't know when he has repaid that 15 loan. So we'll try to take an average there. After tax, what is the future tax rate? Tax rate is 40. So I need to consider only 60%. 1 minus T. 1 minus 40% is 60%. Guys, you can make alternative assumption. You can say that the 15 is repaid at the end of the year and you can calculate on 180. Or you can say 15 is repaid at the beginning of the year, calculate on 165. Without making any assumption, I just said that, you know, take an average so that, you know, you are considering that it is repaid in the in between of the year. Amount is? FMP per LT funds 289.43. Capital employed 2nd determinant, start with average capital employed as per equity fund. This is equity fund. To get long term funds, we have to add back long term funds. Again, there are two long term funds, 180 and 165. Let's take an average. 180 plus 165 by 2. 172.5. So we get capital employed as per long term fund. This is 1727.4. Now you know FMP, now you know capital employed, you can calculate goodwill. LT funds goodwill, long term fund goodwill. Use the same capitalization method. FMP as per LT funds is 289.43. NRR, long term fund NRR is 12%. So you should get what is normal capital employed. Divide it, you get normal capital employed. Compare this normal capital employed with average capital employed. Average capital employed as per long term fund. Is 1727.4. Compare these two, we will arrive at goodwill as per long term fund. Your long-term fund goodwill is 684.52 and equity fund goodwill is 250.43. So for 250.43, there itself I told you already, you will get adverse effect because he's paying higher amount of interest than their NRR. definitely you get a lower amount, an adverse amount. So check the adverse leverage. Adverse leverage effect on goodwill. Compare both. 684.52 minus 250.43. That is 434.09. Like I told you, you can have multiple answers, guys. If I'm staking even the stock adjustment of our opening stock, then I'll get a complete different answer. Write this as a note below. Stock adjustment is only considered on closing stock. In absence of specific information, to provide the adjustment on opening stock. So if someone gives an adjustment for the opening stock, you'll have a complete different set of answers. Let's go for the next one. Problem 6. The balance sheet of D Limited as on 31st March 2011 is as under. I have 1,25,000 shares of 100 rupees each. There is some balance sheet which is given to you. Come down below. In 1989, the company started its activities. The paid up capital was the same. The profits for the last 5 years, first year incurring a loss, remaining years having a profits. Income tax so far has been 40%. Above profits being arrived at on the basis of such tax rate. From 2010-2011, the income tax rate will be taken at 45. Guys, all the above profits have been considered by taking a tax rate of 40% only. But my future effective tax rate is 45. So add back tax first, get the PBT, and then you deduct tax at a later point of time. 10% dividend has been paid for 2007-8 and 8-9 and 15% dividend for 9-10 and 10-11. Market price is 125. With effect from 1st April 2011, the managing director's remuneration will be 20 lakhs instead of 15 lakhs and the company secured a contract where the additional 10 lakhs rupees per annum in the next 5 years will be earned. calculate the goodwill based on 3 years purchase of super profits. For the purpose of calculating FMP, you always take weighted average for the purpose. So he clearly specified saying that, you know, you need to take a weighted average for the FMP calculation. So you have past profits, you can take your average. So the first determinant that we'll calculate is the future maintainable profits. Future maintainable profits is clearly asking us to take a weighted average. We'll start with average profits. All these are profit after tax. Calculate. Start with the year 2006-07. Seven, eight, nine, ten, finally 10, 11. Profits are 13,75,000 negative. Next year, 24,55,000 positive. Next year, 29,25,000 positive. Next year, 36,25,000 positive. Final year, 42,50,000 positive. These are the 5 years given to you, and you need to apply weights. You are trying to value as on 1st April 2011. So most recent year, highest weight. Earliest year, least weight. So your weights should be 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. The sum of weights being 15. Multiplying weight into profit, 13,75,000 negative in the first case. For second one, 49,10,000. Third one, 87,75,000. Next one, 1 crore 45 lakhs. Two crore 12 lakh 50,000. Sum of all this. 4 crore 80 lakh 60,000 is your sum of profits. So when we have to calculate our average, average PAT, 4 crore 80 lakh 60,000 divided by 15, average PAT is 3 lakhs change. 32,04,000. That is your average profits after tax. All these profits have been considered with a tax rate of, tax rate so far has been 40%, and the above profits have been arrived on the basis of such tax rate. So all these are deducted for 40% tax. You add back tax, you get average PBT. Guys, if I have taken 40% tax, 100 rupee profit before tax, 40 rupees tax, profit after tax is 60. If this is 60, then how much is 100? 3204000 into 100 divided by 60. 53,40,000. PVD. Two adjustments. Exactly two adjustments for PVD. Consider, what are the two adjustments? First one, managing director's remuneration is 20 lakhs instead of 15 lakhs. How much should I decrease the profit or increase the profit? Managing director's remuneration is increasing, so my profit should decrease by 5. Adjustments. FMP adjustments. First one. MD remuneration. Managing director's remuneration increased by 5 lakhs. My profits will obviously decrease by 5 lakhs. Second one. The company secured a contract from which it is additionally earning 10 lakhs per annum. So revenue from additional contract. ₹10 lakhs positive. Net FMP pre-tax. My pre-tax FMP is 58,40,000. Future effective tax rate has to be deducted to get FMP post-tax. What is the future effective tax rate? The income tax rate should be taken as 45% from 2010-11. So, FMP post-tax. Or you can show the deduction for tax and then calculate FMP post-tax. Or directly you can calculate 58,40,000 minus 45%. Or simply multiply it by 55%. FMP post tax after taxation of 45% is 32,12,000. Capital. Now you can go for capital employed, guys. Guys, I need average capital employed. Well, I don't have opening figures here. So all I can get is closing capital employed. So to get average capital employed, we need to deduct half of current year profits. Where is the current year profit? Current year is 2010-11. 10-11 profit is 42,50,000 already given. So that profit into 1 by 2, you get your average capital employed. So first start with closing. My second determinant. I will start with terminal capital employed or closing capital employed. Assets, goodwill valuation, I won't consider goodwill. What else can we consider? Building. There's no revaluation to the assets. So realization, realizable value, I'll take it as book value itself. 80 lakhs for building. Machinery is 70 lakhs. Stock, 80 lakhs. Finally, last one, debtors, anyways, all are considered good. 50 lakhs. Total is 2 crores, 80 lakhs of assets. Reduce it with the amount of outside liabilities. Balance sheet liability side. Reverse order. First one, P&L, outside, not an outside liability. Provision for tax. Compulsory outside liability. ₹12,75,000. Creditors, Outside liability again. 52,75,000. Bank OD. OD. Bank OD is also an outside liability. 46,50,000. So this should be 1,12,00,000. I can calculate closing capital employed or terminal capital employed from this. Terminal capital employed is 1,68,00,000. This is closing. To get average, deduct less 1/2 into current year profit. Current year profit is 2010-11. 1/2 into 42,50,000. This is 21,25,000. Average capital employed. ₹1,46,75,000. You got the second determinant. First one was FMP, second one was average capital employed, then third one is NRR, which is not given to us. But to get our NRR, we'll use either dividend yield or earnings yield. What is given? Dividends are given, so we can use dividend yield method. Dividend yield method for NRR calculation. How do you calculate NRR? Dividend yield. DPS by MPS into 100. That is my dividend yield calculation for NRR. Dividends are paid at the rate of 10% for 2007-8 and 8-9 and 15% for 9-10 and 10-11. From this I can get what is the average dividend percentage. For 2 years. 15% for another 2 years. Divided by 4 years. 12.5%. Average dividend per share, 12.5% of face value. Each share is 100. 12.5 rupees. Market price per share already given to us as 125. Calculate NRR then. DPS 12.5, MPS 125 into 100, 10%. Now check three determinants: FMP post tax, average capital employed, NRR, super profits, number of years purchase is 3 years, already given. Start calculating goodwill then. Goodwill by super profits. Goodwill calculation as per super profits method. Check. First one. Consider your FMP. 32,12,000. Compare this with normal profits so that we get super profit. How do you calculate normal profits? NRR multiplied by average capital employed. NRR is 10%. Average capital is 1,46,75,000. This is 14,67,500. Comparing these two, I can get my super profit. My super profit is 17,44,500. And finally, come to the value of goodwill. 3 years purchase multiplied by 3. So this should be 52 lakhs. What is this? 33,500. Goodwill is 52,33,500. A simple problem, guys. There's not many adjustments also in this problem. Yes, guys, let's go for the next one. Problem number 7. Summarize balance sheet of domestic limited as on 31st March 2012 is as under. There's some balance sheet given. And come down below. The resale value of the plant and premise and land is 1200 and that of the plant and machinery is 2400 lakhs. Depreciation applicable on motor vehicle is 20%. And the applicable depreciation on premises and land is 2%. And that on plant and machinery is 10%. The market value of the investment is 1500. 10% of the book value of the book debts is bad. In a similar company of a market value of shares of the similar denomination is 25 rupees per share. And in such company, dividend is constantly paid for the 5 years at 20%. Contrary to this, domestic limited has a market upward or downward trend in the dividend payment. For the past 5 years, the profits are given to you as under 67, 1305 loss, 469 profit, 546 profit and 405 profit. The unusual negative profitability for the year 2007-8 was due to a lockout in the major manufacturing unit of the company, which happened in the beginning of the second quarter for the year 2006-07 and continued until the last quarter of 2007-08. The value of the goodwill, value the goodwill based on 4 years purchase of super profits, necessary adjustment for the company's inconsistency with regard to dividend payment may be made. Guys, if you observe, there are two abnormal years in this. One is 2006-07 and 7-8. Though 6-7 has some profit, he is clearly saying that there is some lockout, and such lockout started in the second quarter of 2006-07. That means even 6-7 year is abnormal. 7-8 year is abnormal. I cannot consider it for the purpose of average profits. So what I'll consider for average is only 2008-09, 2009-10 and 2010-11. One best thing for this problem is there's no tax adjustment given. No tax given as far as the adjustment is concerned. If you observe, there's no tax rate at all. So when there's no tax rate, don't consider, don't try to complicate the problem saying that provision for tax is so much, current year profit is so much, let's identify what is the amount of tax, unnecessary calculations. Let's try to avoid tax. We'll start with saying that ignoring taxation, we are solving the problem because there's no tax percentage which is given. So let's start. Guys, though we are only having 2008-09, 2009-10, and 2010-11 to be considered, there's one more year that can be considered, current year 2011-12. 11-12 profits also can be considered. 2006-07 and 2007-08, we have ruled it off saying they are abnormal years. 8-9, 9-10, 10-11 are normal years. Along with that, we also have 11-12, current year. Current year on the liability side, profit for the year after taxation is 1100. So that is the current year profits. However, there are some adjustments for current year profits which we have to consider before we take an average of the profits. What are the adjustments to be considered? Check. The first one, depreciation of motor vehicles has not been provided. Second thing, premise and land is shown at cost. It is given as a depreciation to be taken as 2%. Plant and machinery depreciation to be taken as 10%. So three depreciations I have to take. Next, 10% book debts are bad. So whenever there's bad debt, you need to decrease the current year profits. So that's it. These are the adjustments to be considered to calculate your corrected profits of current year. So let's start. Put down heading corrected profits of current year. Corrected profits we need. Go on guys, let's start 2011-12. Corrected profits for the current year 2011-12. Now how do we consider the current year corrected profits? Check. First start with corrected current year profits. What is the current year profits given to us? Current year profits already given to us is 1100. So start with that figure. And provide depreciation, corrected profits for the current year. Let's start with the current year profits first. Current year profits given in the balance sheet on the liability side, given profits are 1100. How many adjustments we have? First three depreciations. He's clearly saying that he has taken the fixed assets at cost. Everything, premises and land at cost, motor vehicles at cost, purchased on 110. So they are given at cost. So we need to take some depreciation percentages on that. So let's consider the depreciation percentages. Premises on land 2%. 2% of premises and land is basically having a value of how much? Market value. What is the market value given there? Yeah, there's nothing given. So directly you can take it on 400. Premises and land is 2%. 2% on 400. Next one, plant and machinery is 10%. Plant and machinery is 10%. 10% of 3000. Last one, motor vehicles. We need to consider only 6 months depreciation. 20% on motor vehicles value of 40, 6/12. What are the amounts of depreciation? First one is 8, second one is 300 negative, next one is 4 negative. One last adjustment to be given is bad debts. Check the bad debts. Check the bad debt adjustment, guys. Where is the bad debts? Yep, 10% of bad debt, book debts are considered bad. Observe, the amount is 400 there. So 400 into 10% is 40. So identify corrected current year profits. The corrected current year profits are 748. Now you have how many years? 4 years of profits to be taken as average. 8, 9, 9, 10, 10, 11, and now corrected current year profits of 11, 12. So if you observe, is there any particular trend in the profits? 469 increased to 546, again down to 405, again increase. There is no particular trend that I can take. So take average profits directly. Simple average, 469 plus 546 plus 405 plus 748 divided by 4 years. 2 years considered as abnormal years. I am not considering for the purpose of computation of FMP at all. There's no FMP adjustments, guys. Your average profits only are FMPs. There's no adjustment for FMP. And the average is 542. You can take the 542 as FMP because there's no particular adjustments which are given there. All your adjustments are only to your capital employed. So start your capital employed now. Go for the computation of capital employed. Start with your assets. First calculate terminal capital employed. You know current year profits to be deducted half. No problem for that.
I'm starting with my terminal capital employed. Assets, first one, premises and land. There is a resale value given there, check, come down below. The resale value of premises and land is 1200. Plant and machinery, resale value given to you as 2400. Vehicles, I'm not given any resale value for vehicles. How much should I consider? 40 was the purchase value. I depreciated it by 4. 36. I did not take depreciation adjustment for plant and machinery and premises and land because I'm directly taking resale values. So I don't have to deduct depreciation. Vehicles I'm deducting because I'm taking book value. Next, raw material. 920. Next, work in progress. 130. Finished goods. 180. Book debts. We have considered bad debts in calculating book debts. 10% bad debt, 360. Investment held for the purpose of replacement of plant and machinery, trade or non-trade, trade investment because it is held for the purpose of the business, investments can be considered as trade investments. The trade investment for 1600. Yep, I have cash 192. That is total assets. Reduce it by outside liabilities. What about the other assets below cash in bank? Once again guys, your market value of investments is 1500. I'm really sorry for that. There's a market value which is given. Outside liabilities. Outside liabilities, guys, go one by one. Creditors first. I'm going in the reverse way always. Creditors 300. Next. Secured loan 200. Next, debentures, outside liability. One more outside liability, can anyone spot? There's one more. Check, in your reserves, below reserves, what did he write? Including provision for taxation of 300, provision for tax is definitely an outside liability. He's just included it in reserves. You can't complain against the examiner saying why did you include there, not a right inclusion and all. That is only for you to get confused. So there is an outside liability which you need to consider. Comparing all this, try to get your terminal capital employed. Once you get terminal capital employed, you can reduce half of current year profits, which you already know. Current year profits, we already calculated. We have corrected it to 748. So that we get average capital employed.
Average capital employed is 3744. NRR is given? No. Check, what did he give? There is no NRR which is given there. You need to calculate your NRR based on some assumptions, some calculations which you have to make. Critical calculations, guys, as far as NRR is concerned. Check what is the information available. Based on that, we'll frame our working note for NRR. Did you observe? In a similar company with the market value of the equity share of the same denomination is 25 rupees. I'm giving MPS. There should be one more figure I need, either DPS or EPS. Then I can calculate NRR by earnings yield or dividend yield method. What did he give? So in such company, dividend is constantly paid in the last 5 years at 20%. Is it for domestic limited that I am talking about? No. I am talking about a similar company like domestic limited. It has a dividend payout constantly at 20%, whose market value today is 25 rupees. But for domestic limited, he is saying there is a market upward or a downward trend in dividend payment. What is happening? That means if you get higher profit, then he is paying higher dividend. If you are getting lower profits, he is paying lower dividend. Think from the risk of the shareholder, high, low. In domestic limited, the shareholder's risk in comparison with a similar company which is given here, is your risk higher or lower? I would say that the risk is higher for an investor because he himself is not sure what is the rate of dividend that he might earn. He might earn less, he might even earn more. So whenever there's erratic dividend payments, up and down if your dividend keeps moving, then we can say that the risk of the equity shareholder is definitely higher than a company which is paying constant dividend at the rate of 20%. What I'll calculate is NRR for a similar company. When I'm coming down to NRR of domestic limited, since there is an erratic dividend payment, there should be a risk premium that should be added. How much risk premium? That is the reason why last sentence he wrote. In brackets, necessary adjustment for the company's inconsistency with regard to dividend payment may be made. What we'll do is we'll calculate. Now we'll add something so that we'll get a nearest round figure. Okay. So let's calculate NRR of similar company. Put on a heading NRR. This is the third determinant. We already got FMP. We already got capital employed. Last NRR. NRR by dividend yield method. Chalo, NRR of similar company. DPS. Dividend percentage is 20%. Face value of the share is 10. DPS by MPS into 100. 20% of 10 divided by MPS. 25 into 100. NRR looks to be 8%. Your wish. Chalo. Plus risk premium for inconsistent dividend. Shall I add 2%? So that I get NRR of domestic limited at 10. We will have calculators, no? Take 1% also, doesn't make any difference. Your answers might be different, but your answer is absolutely right. They can't contest upon your answer, your assumption that is. Even 25 is a round figure, so don't add 17%, okay? It sounds more unrealistic. And 1, 2, sufficient. 0.5 also sufficient. Go on. NRR there. Average capital employed here. Average profits are nothing but FMP. This is also there. Super profits method. What is the valuation of goodwill? Yep, 4 years profits. 4 years purchase of super profits. Start calculating. Goodwill valuation by super profit method. First one. FMP 542 average profits apply 10% of capital employed 4118 no I'm sorry this is terminal right average is 3744 374.4 super profit is 167.6 goodwill how many years purchase 4 into 4 I think this is 660.4 670.4 670.4 Yes guys, that's your answer for goodwill 670.4 super profits method. What is the assumption that we have taken in this problem? This anyways he said you can assume. One thing which we have to write a note for, check, as far as the assets were concerned, he wrote premises and land at cost. This is given. So I have deducted depreciation, no problem. Your motor vehicles at cost, happily he gave in. So I took the depreciation on this, but plant and machinery 3000 directly given. Now, who told you that it is not depreciated? We did not have any information saying that it is not depreciated. So if you say that the plant and machinery is already depreciated, then this will not come. Now, why did I take the depreciation then? Since anyways premise and land he said is this is at cost, then I have assumed that basically he is not taking depreciation. So that's the reason why I depreciated even for this on a uniformity basis. So this is an assumption that we have made that the depreciation has not been charged on your plant and machinery. I don't need to write for vehicles or premises. I need to only write for plant and machinery. Assume that depreciation on plant and machinery is not provided for. Can I assume the contrary? You can assume. There's nothing wrong. Like I told you, then valuation you will have multiple answers.